there's only so many pastors they can have. And if their pastor's Al Sharpton right now, that's fine. But then that's it. We don't want any more black pastors coming in here, or other Jesse Jackson, whoever was in here earlier this week, sitting with the victim's family, trying to influence a jury in this case.
Pastor Bryant, we have got two vigilante trials underway right now. And one where in Georgia, where the defense, who knows that his clients are gonna go to jail, it's just a matter of how much time they will get, who's now looking at black pastors as influencers of the court and intimidation as well. What do you say to this?
It is disheartening in one end and encouraging in another. In recent vintage, there's been a large discussion, is the black church relevant? Does the black pastor still have impact and influence? And this attorney has resoundingly made it clear that black pastors still have a role in the pursuit of justice in America. It's disheartening that there's so many people who still think this way. What is skewed is that it found a problematic that the victim's family would have support from anybody. But April, I want to enlarge the conversation to say it shouldn't just be black pastors, but white pastors should be offering affirmation and prayers and encouragement. We've got historical evidence and reference of having pastors of different walks of faith and ethnicities walking alongside. And so I'm hoping that other pastors will stand with us.
I understand next week other pastors may stand with you. I understand that there's a call for at least 100 black pastors to pray for the family. And yes, when you have, being part of the black churches have been, when you have one group of ministers, others join. And it's kind of like what happened with Bloody Sunday, the march for voting. When you see the atrocity, when they see the overt racism, others join in to say it's got to stop. What are you expecting next week in this call for 100 ministers? I'm saying that's going to be a conservative estimate.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a revival, a renaissance, as it was, of conscientious faith in action. Our own Frederick Douglass, who hailed out of Maryland, that abolitionist, said, I got more prayers answered when I got off my knees. And so this is going to be a critical juncture in history where our actions have got to speak louder than our words. And so I'm really looking not just for faith leaders to come, but congregants are going to assemble to show their support.
It's so interesting when you said that about Frederick Douglass, when he had more prayers answered when he got off his knees. But the thing that just came to my mind, the old hymn, when I fall on my knees with my face towards the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
Yes.
What is the mercy that we need in this moment as it relates to Georgia? You're in Georgia. What is
yes.
that mercy?
We need an avalanche of mercy. When we're looking at voting rights under attack, we need an avalanche of mercy with pending, redistricting. Let's not forget that the state's attorney is under indictment because of this case, that this is a really deep-seated mosaic of the culture. I learned as a Georgia transplant, April, somebody said this to me that I'll say to your listeners, there's Atlanta and then there's Georgia. And so what people are saying is beyond the shadow of the Olympics, but to show that the vestiges of racism are still alive in this country and are deep-seated. Let's not forget, April, just a week ago, former President Trump appeared at the World Series in Georgia and was met by an arousing stand of ovation. Was greeted as a patriot of those in this state who really believed that he was making America great.
In an unusual twist, the defense has said he wants to give the opening, same man who got up talking about the black pastors. As
yes.
if we are, or black people, black pastors, as if black pastors are killing people.
Yes.
They're intimidating and influencing. As a black pastor, as someone who has fought racism, as someone who is on the forefront, marching with the King family, marching with Reverend Jackson, marching with Reverend Sharpton. What did that do to you as soon as you heard that?
As an aside, April, here's what I don't want people to miss, is that the attorney didn't even know Sharpton was in the courtroom. He said he found out that night, which debunks his whole argument. The fact that he didn't even know he was in the room means that he didn't feel intimidated.
And he called Reverend Barber, Reverend Jackson. Reverend Jackson's supposed to come today. Reverend right. Barber was in the courtroom.
Right. So we all look alike, April. And so it was a tragicomedy. To say the absolute least. It wasn't until he got, I guess, to happy hour or got back home that the fellas started to call him to say, how did you let that blank preacher in the courtroom, that he came back the next day fired up on what it is that he needed to do. And so no intimidation was done. It was just a reflection of the ghost of Christmas past that showed up and kept him up that night.
That wasn't even Christmas. That was Halloween. Okay.
That was not Christmas.
That was Halloween. That was Hallow's Eve.
Yes.
But seriously, I mean, as someone who has reverence for church, someone who's been in church, particularly the Black church, it was offensive. What are you getting from your congregants? What are you hearing? What are you hearing? Because you have vast tentacles all over the place. What are
you hearing? Yes, preachers have been calling me nonstop. When are we going? This is Spike Lee's remix, Get on the Bus. and people are calling me with an outcry saying, how dare you just say to preachers to come? we want to come and be of support and be in prayer. And so there's a great organic movement that is taking place headed towards Brunswick, Georgia. We're meeting later to figure out what is the best day for this to happen, but the week will not pass without us coming.
With that said, there is a response. That is a response, and it's a natural response, as you said, to this racist statement from the defense attorney. However, I can't say who said this, but one of the attorneys who's connected to the trial said, this gentleman wants a mistrial. I'm being kind at the very least.
Yes.
The defense attorney wants a mistrial and he wants to create a lot of frenzy around the trial. With that said, the reaction, what he said will create a reaction. How are you all trying to make sure it does not impede upon the process of the trial? To give him, the defense attorney, yes. what he wants, because he wants a mistrial.
Well, it's in line and in keeping with what you posted earlier about our assembly. It is not to disrupt the court, but to be in prayer with the family, to let them know that they've got a army of people who are praying with them and standing with them. The court, April, is not that big. And so we're not looking to invade or to disrupt the process, but to really let the family and the community know that there is a great force field of support and love and prayer that stands with them. But no, we do not want to disrupt the proceedings in any measure.